Souls and mixing martinis in our Shady and Shaky show. Joining me are a shady lady, Victoria Coren Mitchell. The Shadow Minister of Mirth, Eshaan Akbar. The Sheik of Shenanigans, John Barrowman. And shaking it all about, it's Alan Davis. Hey. Right, let's hear their Shady Shaky signature tunes. Victoria goes. Cause I'm Slim Shady, yes, I'm
the real Shady. All you want the Slim Shady's a Justin
Martini. Eshaan
goes.
The shadow of your smile. Nice. Really nice.
Oh, be careful, Eshaan, you'll pull. John goes. It comes to life.
Perfect.
And Alan goes. Well, put your left arm in. Right. Name something that was invented in either Shaky Town or Shady Town.
I mean, I'm hoping this is a Shaken Stevens question.
Oh!
Because I know a lot about him.
Why?
Because I was a big fan of him as a child. And you know the stuff you learnt, well, child, as a teenager.
It's inexcusable. Yeah.
It's not inexcusable. He was a bit. Let me tell you, tomorrow is Shaken Stevens' 73rd birthday.
No.
And I still would. Because.
Yes.
Not only.
Yeah.
Is he gorgeous? But when you're young, those kind of things go in. I know his birthday, favourite colour, indigo, real name, Michael Barrett, stage name, taken from his old school friend, Stephen van der Valk. He took the name.
Can I just say, I've no idea how we got here. That's all I'm saying. I wanted to get to seismology and geology.
Is it something to do with a Shaky Town, something to do with, like, an earthquake machine?
That's exactly right. So, modern seismology began in Comrie Village, so it's in Perthshire. It's your part of the world, isn't it?
Up in Scotland.
Scotland. Yeah.
An earthquake machine in Scotland?
Yes, it's known as Shaky Toon. How was that?
Very good. That was brilliant.
Shaky tune. So, incredible number of earthquakes, which you maybe wouldn't even think of in Scotland. The late 18th to the mid-19th century, thousands of earthquakes. There is a thing called the Highland Boundary Fault, and the position of this town is astride the fault. And it still records more and stronger tremors than anywhere else in Britain. It is officially Britain's shakiest town. And so they wanted to measure it, and it's the very first purpose-built seismology station in the world, known as Earthquake House. It's basically a hut in a field, if I'm honest with you.
It looks like a public toilet.
It's so British. Look what we've made.
How about you open the door and you can see to the core of the earth.
It was instigated by the Comrie pioneers, basically the local postmaster. He devised one of the earliest measures for earthquakes. So a 10 was a quake that they had in October of 1839, which was felt over most of Scotland.
Oh, that's when the teapot rattles.
Yeah. So the Comrie scale is different scales of quake. So number 10, massive quake in 1839. And then number one I like is called Just Sensible.
What?
Yeah, just capable of being sensed.
It's a quiver.
Oh.
It's more of a... Oh, we've all had those.
That's a different kind of earthquake.
Is that it, yeah. So, incredibly simple mechanism. You get two wooden beams. You get one going north and south and one going east and west like that with wooden cylinders of various sizes on top. And it took various sizes of quake to get the cylinders to fall off. It's not very complicated. And then Sod's Law stepped in. They built the earthquake house. And that coincided pretty much with the end of the great era of earthquakes in Comrie.
The earthquake it just moved on.
Yeah.
They've built something. Let's go.
Yeah. But we now realise that this hut is of historic significance, and they've in fact updated it with modern equipment so sensitive it picked up the tsunami on Boxing Day 2004 in Indonesia. So that is
exactly. No way. Yeah.
Right. So we've done Shaky Toon. Let's go to Shady Town. It is, I can tell you, also in Scotland. Any thoughts?
A place where the sun never shines?
Yes, darling, it is. Locranza on Arran. It is the UK's, possibly the world's, shadiest town. It gets fewer annual hours of sunshine than anywhere else because it sits on a sort of north-facing glen on a rainy island. It has no streetlights. I have to say I've been there and it is extremely beautiful, but it is also the birthplace of modern geology. So we've got two places in Scotland that have done wonders for the study of the planet. The man is known as the father of modern geology, James Hutton. He visited in 1787, and he discovered, it was the very first example of what's called Hutton's unconformity. And I love this because I notice it and don't know what it is, but it's a junction between different types of rock formation. Mm. And he developed the idea that such formations could only have resulted over unimaginable time, so the Earth could not be young, as the Bible claimed. So I think we can just show you with some writing on the top. Can you see how you've got the ones that are the structures that are going up like that? Isn't it incredible? Anyway, he wrote a line in a 1788 paper which has, well, it's echoed through geological science ever since. The result, therefore, of our present inquiry is that we find no vestige of a beginning, no prospect of an end. It's really lovely. Modern seismology and geology were invented 60 miles from each other in Scotland. Describe the dark side of puppeteering.
Well, surely it's everything that goes on.
Yeah.
Underneath.
Below the
desk. That's the way to do it.
Dread to think.
Alan, stop playing with your puppet under the table.
What do all the other puppets do when you put them down?
Specific kind of puppetry that we're thinking of, the dark side of puppetry. Any thoughts?
Shadows?
What about Hank Marvin? Would you or wouldn't you?
I tell you what, Cliff Richard, I definitely would. Don't say anything. I would.
Talking about a specific type of shadow puppetry, I've got some examples here. So it's Java, Indonesia, Southeast Asia. It's a 1,000-year-old form of a shadow puppet theatre called a wayang. So they often tell Hindu epics. The only thing is, the shows can last 8 or more hours, right?
Of course they can. I mean, if it's in a Bollywood film, they last 16 days.
Yes, exactly that.
I mean, all puppet shows feel like they've lasted 8 or 9 hours.
The ninth hour of the Punch of Judy.
Unfortunately, it is a skill which is very slightly dying out. So some of the puppeteers have taken to performing Star Wars-themed shows, for example, to younger audiences, and they take some liberties. So there we've got Chewbacca and Han Solo.
I am all for that.
You think that's okay?
Love it. Still have my original Star Wars toys. I have a whole section of the garage devoted to Star Wars memorabilia. I even have my Star Wars pajama, you know, pants. And I go to... Don't laugh at me! I go to bed dressed.
Where else is he going to keep his lightsaber at night?
I mean, well, I love nothing.
Yeah. Whoa, but yeah, whoa. Massive Star Wars fan. I love that. I think that's a great idea.
Do you only have the trousers?
No, I have the top of it too, but it's like I have one that's Darth Vader pants, and then on the top it says, "I'm your daddy."
It's just so wrong.
I've never watched Star Wars.
Did you want to confess anything while we're doing this? Like turning it into therapy?
Well, yeah, maybe. I don't know.
I think that seeing Star Wars is a confession in itself.
That is quite a big. Alan, did you have anything you wanted to reveal to the rest of the world?
Oh,
actually,
man.
I asked you this once and you told me you'd pooed on Hampstead Heath or something.
Oh, yes. That's right, and I'm not falling into this trap again.
Lovely. Anyway, they're now using Wayang shows, which is what this puppetry is, to explain all sorts of things. They've used it for COVID-19. They use it for the destruction of coral reefs. I mean, all sorts of kind of educational stuff. It's quite complex, and traditionally, there's just one puppet master who's called a dalang, and they are highly respected, and it used to be that Indonesian children wanted to grow up and be a dalang. Oh. Usually, boys would work the puppets, and girls play the genda, which is a bit like a glockenspiel. And the puppets, as you can see, are really intricate. And perversely, considering they're there to create shadows, they're very brightly painted.
Yeah, that is odd, isn't it?
Yes, this is just a curiosity.
This is a move Yas, queen! Snapping, yas, queen, yas! Yas, queen, yas, yas, yas! Yas, queen!
And the puppeteer, it's improv. They improvise most of the play.
So they come out and say, so can someone give me an object? An object situation. Then let's have a feeling, let's have an emotion.
Unusual occupation. Yeah. Let's go for that.
Gynecologist! Yeah.
Can I tell you this about when I first took my daughter to a puppet show? I found this very, very annoying. The puppeteer came out and, you know, had the puppets and spoke to the audience. And I wanted to say, look, fine. After the age of about 30, magnificent, break it down, deconstruct it. See, my child is three. She thinks it's... Just bring it up behind a hay bale.
It's fine. It's
let it be a talking creature.
Have you ever worked with the Muppets?
I have.
Yeah. It's very difficult not to reference them if you don't.
But Kermit's the weirdest one because it's like on his head. It's on his head and then he's working the hands like that.
I still would.
Of course.
What's shady and two-dimensional about this guy? So, if I give you his name, it may help. He was the French Minister of Finance for just 8 months under Louis the 15th, and he was called Étienne de Silhouette.
Is that why Silhouette? Because he's thought of as a shadowy figure?
It's why shadow portraits, you know the portraits where you just get the sort of outline of a person done in black?
Yes.
They're known as silhouettes, and it is because his... Well, the normal explanation, his austerity policies, which eventually got him fired, caused his name to be associated with sort of general thriftiness. And these were cheaper portraits for people who couldn't afford to have oil portraits. I think they're very beautiful. But it's not for me to say, we have an expert with us. Please welcome master silhouettist Charles Burns. There he is. Charles, tell me, how did you learn to be a silhouettist? How did that happen?
When I left art college, I worked for a number of years as a street portrait artist in Covent Garden, and drawing portraits originally, and then I started cutting silhouettes more or less as a sideline, but they completely took over my life.
They became very popular in Europe, and they came over, didn't they, from France?
They did. They became very popular throughout the 18th and early 19th centuries, but they died out, really, when photography was invented and all the silhouette artists went out of business.
Which I think is a great shame. In fact, studios used to be equipped sometimes with a
physionotrace is the word you're looking for. Yes. The physionotrace was like an arm, like a metal bar, which used to be passed around someone's profile. And at the other end of the bar was a little pencil, which on a small piece of paper would draw upside down and in reverse their profile.
But you don't do anything as...
No, I rely entirely on a pair of scissors.
Pair of scissors
and a technique I call cut and hope.
Okay, I like that. So you're going to do our silhouettes while we're carrying on chatting. So can I get you to sit and carry on?
I shall go and explore your
profile. Imagine you're on a coin. While he's cutting away, I can tell you there was even an automaton called Prosopographus. So prosopon is Greek for face. And it was set up in the 1820s on the Strand in London by a silhouette artist called Charles Hervé. And it was a sort of small robotic figure sitting on a box with a tablet in one hand and a stylus on the other. And it drew an outline of your face, which could then be cut into a silhouette. We have no idea how the automaton worked, although some visitors reported seeing human eyes behind the curtain. So we are assuming there was a human inside. Have a quick look at this and tell me what you see here.
Two faces looking at each other.
Two faces looking at each other?
I can see both. I see two faces or a vase.
Or a vase. What do you see, Victoria?
Shaken Stephen.
A sort of goblet or two people.
Yeah.
It is, in fact, known as a Rubin's vase. Some Danish psychologist, Edgar Rubin, 1915. And it's very interesting how the brain decides what is an object and what is the background. So an object sometimes has a sharper colour, there are visual clues, maybe it's closer or it gives you an emotional response. If you remove all of those things, the brain cannot consistently distinguish the object from the background. So depending on how we look at it, might think it's a face immediately, might think it's a vase immediately.
Really?
Yeah. There are two British artists, Tim Noble and Sue Webster. They developed a technique and they create silhouettes from heaps of junk. They started their work in 1997. This is one of their pieces that was at the Royal Academy. So that's just junk. It's old wood and rusty tools and toilet roll and all sorts of things. And that's them in silhouette.
That is amazing.
I think it's one of the best things I've ever seen.
People are so creative. I mean, as an Asian kid growing up, imagine if I told my dad, Dad, I want to do stuff with rubbish and make silhouettes.
Yeah. Just...
yeah. People are like, what are you talking about? Just go on QI.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Don't even need to make silhouettes. Although tonight we can make rubbish and silhouettes because I think Charles has finished. Darling, are you going to reveal for us?
I can reveal for you, yes.
All right. So we'll have Victoria first.
OK. There she is.
There we are. There you are.
Oh. Wow.
Oh. Clever. Yeah, amazing.
Just take a couple of inches off the nose. Just bring
it. Right, should we do Alan?
Oh, oh wow. Oh,
yes.
That's great.
Well, oh, that's look at the, very the little good. Hair detail at the top.
Yeah, yeah. It's amazing. It's very clever.
Yeah. Eshaan?
As long as I don't look like rubbish in this one.
Right.
I look so much older.
The glasses are so brilliant.
Yeah,
yeah, the glasses
that's
are
so clever. Right, Johnny, let's try you, darling. Oh, oh you that. Handsome devil.
So handsome. Yeah,
that's brilliant.
You're so handsome, even lovely. As a cutout.
Wow, I think those are brilliant.
So it's clever. Literally just doing that with a pair of scissors.
Yes, I
have. It's amazing.
Yes. A free hand cut with scissors.
I can't even cut a straight line on wrapping paper.
Straight lines are much harder.
I think you're a secret Doctor Who. You've got the coat, you've got the look, you're a secret doctor.
Yeah. Yeah, this contains everything I need.
See?
Yeah. Charles, it's been such a pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's awesome.
Thank
you.
Okay. Right. What's a McKinley grip?
Ooh.
Ooh.
So, the whole show is shade and shake.
A shaky grip.
A shaky grip?
Well, yes. Shaky grip, yeah.
So what do? We shake parts of our body, we shake...
The only McKinley that I know is William McKinley, the President of the United States.
Absolutely right, is the McKinley grip, yeah.
He was assassinated.
Yes, he was, yeah.
I don't know if he was a Mason or whatever, but I know he's a Republican. So there might have been a secret handshake?
It wasn't a secret, it was that he was fantastically good at shaking hands. There was a tradition throughout the 19th century in the United States that if anybody wanted to, they could turn up at the White House on New Year's Day and shake the President's hand. And President McKinley was in office 1897 to 1901. He was an enthusiastic handshaker, said to have once shaken 5,000 hands in a single session, but it had to be quick, so he developed something called the McKinley grip. What you do is you give a beaming smile, you grab somebody's hand before they have a chance to take yours, you give it a swift squeeze, in your other hand you take hold of the elbow and push them away.
Oh, yeah.
This was okay. The McKinley grip. Just get rid of them like
what
that.
What a metaphor for all social interaction.
I know,
how
isn't it?
Hysterical.
Come here, go away.
But you're quite right. He was engaged in just such a thing when he was murdered. September the 6th, 1901, he was in Buffalo, New York at the Pan American Exposition when an anarchist called Leon Czolgosz turned up and he had his right hand covered with a handkerchief and the president thought he had some injury or other. But in fact, he shot him point blank. He died of infection about 8 days later. Now, here's the thing. We shake hands. We also shake heads. I think we've said this before on this show, Alan. Some countries, like Bulgaria, they shake for yes and nod for no.
Mm.
So we're going to try a little experiment. I'm going to ask you a series of quick-fire questions with yes or no answers, right? You have to answer immediately, but whatever answer you give with your voice, you have to give the opposite with your head.
Oh.
OK? And I'll ping my pinger if you get it wrong. Does everybody understand?
You pinging your pinger?
No, I'm just asking.
Yes, I do.
Yes.
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 I'm trying to catch you out. That's
yes.
All. OK, all right, ready. John. Was the first James Bond film the one about the Doctor?
Yes.
I don't know. That's right.
Is it right?
Yes. What was the name of the Doctor?
No.
Eshaan, do you know what band featured the keyboard player Rick Wakeman?
No.
Don't know?
No. No.
Okay.
But it's yes.
The band is called Yes.
Yes but, is the band.
But you didn't know.
I no.
This would be a great drinking game.
Very
Victoria, do you know what it means when you nod?
Do you know what it means when you nod? Yes, I know what it means. Or, yes, I know what it means.
Alan, have you stopped kicking the dog?
Yes, I never kicked the dog.
Yeah, it's quite complicated. It's quite weird.
Yes.
Nobody knows why the Bulgarians do it the other way around. So there's a folk tale that they were forced to change their religion by invaders, and so they pretended no meant yes when they were interrogated about their faith. It's a bit like crossing your fingers when you tell
That's
a lie.
Great.
So.
I did a movie in Bulgaria, and I was diving in the movie, and that was part of the reason I also got the movie, because I'm a registered diver. They said I had to go in this big tank, and I was given a small canister with oxygen in it. I would breathe, put the oxygen away, then escape from the tank. But I went down, and I said to the guy, "Is it unlocked?" And he went, "Yes." I'm like, "I'm not going down." And he's like, "Is it locked?" "Yes, it is."
What was the film, darling?
Oh, you don't want to know.
No, I really want to see it.
It's called Shark Attack 3 Megalodon.
Oh, my.
All I'll say is it bought me my first place.
There's an even more apparently ambiguous, is the head bobble. So this is a form of non-verbal communication. It's commonly found in India, Pakistan and Sri Lanka. So according to...
Hi, guys.
Yeah. I'm looking at John. According to a behaviourist from Tamil Nadu, Pradeep Chakravarti, it may have evolved to give a deliberately ambiguous signal. So it's a sort of, you can disagree with somebody while not saying anything.
That's
the head bobble?
It means yes, no, maybe means everything, really. Okay. They do it in Bangladesh as well.
Right. But you're being non-committal, is that it?
Yeah, and you're...
Just do it now.
The move is more from the chin, actually, right. So it's just a...
Yas, queen.
But this neck move is very clearly kind of like a no, isn't it? I mean, you know it's a no.
Well, I would, in the gay world, we disagree with that. It's like, get over here.
That is great.
Yes, queen.
Yes. No.
Is there any gesture that isn't that?
So, the head bobble, yeah, the head bobble is from the chin, I think.
From the chin.
It's really hard.
Right. That's pretty good, actually, Alan. Oh. That's a good one.
It's a very relaxed thing. No,
really not.
I mean, I look like I'm trying to decide which kind of herring to have for dinner. That's really right. Here's a pretty shady way to carry on. What's the best way to sabotage a sewage system?
Shadow of your smile.
Begins with S, I'm going to say.
S?
Yes.
Oh, shit. I was going to say... Yeah.
Shit!
I was not going to say that. There you go.
What were you going to say?
Similar to that, let me have a drunken kebab.
Right, and that would be the way forward. Yeah. In 1944, the US Office of Strategic Services, that's the sort of predecessor organisation to the CIA, produced this. And it's a simple sabotage field manual. Oh. And it's a guide to a range of different ways where you can undermine the enemy's... their economy, their morale, their military offensiveness, and so on. And it's fantastic in the scope of stuff in this rather narrow book, Demolishing Bridges, How to Cause Trouble, Quarrels on Public Transport, that kind of thing. So here's how to sabotage a lavatory. So what you do is you saturate a sponge, OK, with a thick starch or sugar solution, right? You squeeze it tightly until it is a ball. You wrap it with string to keep it in the ball, and then you let it dry. Mm. And once it is dry, you remove the string and you flush it down the lavatory. The sponge will gradually expand back to its normal size and it will entirely plug the sewage system.
Oh, and why would you want to do that?
If you want to mess with your enemy, mess with their toilets.
Oh.
Yeah. So some of the stuff they suggest, it's like schoolboy pranks in here. Yeah. But it's just stuff that the enemy would go, oh, now the toilets are backed up in the main office. It's just annoying. So let's try the lighting system in a factory. How would you sabotage the lighting system in a factory?
Cut a wire.
No, it's got to be more subtle than that, you see. So what you do is you turn the lights off, unscrew a light bulb, put a coin into the socket, put the light bulb back in again. As soon as somebody turns it on, the whole system will blow.
Because of the copper?
Yeah. I mean, it's...
I'm going to do that.
You don't, because they don't. It's terrible.
Electricians and plumbers back in the day would have been making an absolute killing.
Yeah, just stick a coin in it.
Oh, it's a sponge, oh, it's a coin. Yeah. He's charging £600 for the privilege.
What about the petrol tank of a vehicle?
Oh, that's sugar, isn't it?
You can do sugar or you can urinate in it.
Urine?
Yeah, just wee in it. I don't know why I'm giving all this away. Please don't do any of these things.
Well, I've heard of them putting, like, a potato in the exhaust.
Yeah, I've heard of...
I like this, the one in here that I think would only work in Britain. To start an argument on a train, if you work for the railway, issue two tickets for the same seat.
Ah, yes.
That's every day.
Yeah.
Yes.
And so we descend into the shadowy realm of shaky misunderstandings that we call general ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. I'm looking forward to my summer holiday. How can I prepare to get a nice, deep suntan without burning?
Sun lotion? Would you not... Sunscreen?
No, probably the very correct answer, my darling, yes. People used to think that the idea was to lay down a sort of base tan, possibly in a tanning salon or something, and it's a widespread thought, but it is entirely wrong. The only way you can protect yourself is with suntan lotion.
Or clothes.
Clothes. Mm. Or you and I would just sit in the shade, wouldn't we, Alan?
Drinking heavily.
So they wanted to demonstrate this, so they needed some skin that had zero exposure to the sun, so they chose British bottoms. Yeah. And they were exposed to simulated sunlight.
Replicate conditions at the centre of the earth.
Can I just say what an awful representation of the United States of America that picture is?
Yeah. It's not pretty, is it?
No.
No. Would you or wouldn't you, Victoria?
I think he looks all right.
It's all right. Anyway. 2 weeks they spent with simulated sunlight on naked buttocks, and the resulting tan gave them a tiny bit of protection. Basically, it meant you could spend an extra 10 minutes in the sun. And tanning parlour sunbeds are really as bad, if not worse, than natural sunlight. Indeed, indoor tanning causes about 420,000 cases of skin cancer a year in the US alone.
What?
Yeah. Now, this is exciting. We've done a bit of research on who is in line for the throne, and we know the correct answer to this question. Which of you on this panel is closest to inheriting the crown?
I look good.
I think we all deserve a yas, Queen.
Yas!
I love it. I'm a classy.
It must be Alan.
Wow.
Well, it must be. I explain how it's not Alan.
Here's the truth of it, it's none of us.
No, it can't be none of us. You said who's the closest.
Yeah.
Close. No, we could all be far away.
Nobody.
Somebody... No.
Nobody.
No.
Most people think that we're all somehow in line to the throne eventually, even if you're number 52,000,014 or whatever.
Yeah.
In fact, the list of succession is extremely limited. You have to be a direct descendant of Princess Sophia, Electress of Hanover. He was born in The Hague in 1630.
Oh, great Granny Sophia. That's where the family hair began.
It could be.
This was painted just a week after she shat on Hampstead Heath.
Do you not think it's weird that she looks surprised to be having her portrait done?
I like the look of her.
She's rather fine. She was the granddaughter of James I, so she was chosen as heir to the throne to ensure a Protestant lineage in the event that William or Queen Anne died without issue. And it was to block the old pretender James Stuart, who was a Catholic. Unfortunately, she died 2 months before she was due to take over, so we got her son, George I. And it's a shame, because she was extraordinary. She spoke 5 languages, she was educated in theology, history, mathematics, law. She was buried in the Burggarten Mausoleum in Hanover, and ironically, considering that all British royalty is descended from her, that was almost completely destroyed by Allied bombers during World War II.
Wow.
Which brings us to the scores. Looking distinctly shaky in last place, with -7, it's Alan!
Thank you. Thank you.
Third place with -3, Victoria! Yay. Second with 1 point, John! Yas Queen!
Yas Queen!
Shadowing everybody is tonight's winner with 5 points, Eshaan! My thanks to Victoria, Eshaan, John and Alan. I leave you with this shadowy sign-off from Chinese philosopher Lin Yutang. When small men begin to cast big shadows, it means that the sun is about to set. Good night.